The more I explore emotions, the more I realized how biased I am against the negative ones. Noticing this trend has led to a radical thought. What if there are no negative emotions? What if there are no good and bad emotions? What if each emotion has a gift that no other emotion can give us? Am I passing up the gift of all the lower emotions because I'm too arrogant to believe they don't have something of value to offer me? All right. Well, I should have proofread it a little better, but that's all right. Last night, I started reading a book called The Gift of Fear, where the author talks about situations where people were victimized. I found myself being turned off by it. It didn't feel empowering to see other people as a victim, but he took things to a deeper level by talking about how our intuition can predict and steer us away from violence before it happens. In that sense, we're not really a victim of others' actions, but not following our own guidance. As fate would have it, today I had an experience where I felt like a victim. But instead of just acting like a victim, I owned it. I asked you to stop repeatedly and you didn't. That's like rape. Maybe I was being a little melodramatic, especially since the only things being hurled at me were words. But there was something soothing about seeing myself as a victim. It made it okay for me to feel like I did because it felt like the appropriate response to that situation. Instead of beating myself up for feeling in a negative place, I understood why I felt the way I did. Naming it actually caused me to feel less like a victim. I immediately cut myself some slack and stopped being a victim of my own self-judgment. No longer saddled by my own infighting, I could focus on the circumstances at hand with fresh eyes. I felt empowered to shift the situation now that I knew what role I was playing in it. And once I made that shift, whatever I was doing to attract the behavior that was victimizing me ended too. It feels weird putting it that way, but identifying myself as a victim actually made me feel more empowered. The moment I had this realization, I thought back to the gift of fear. After feeling the power of being a victim firsthand, I now felt eager to crack open the book and read it with an open mind. In fact, I wasn't a victim at all. I was the benefactor of an experience that helped me connect with a desire I never even knew I had. I never would have guessed that I would want to feel like a victim, but feeling it led to the profound realization about my life's work. Now the side project I've been working on that involves navigating the emotional scale from the lowest lows to the highest highs has become the work I want to build my life around. I want to find a way to focus on it more and more and include others in the process and write a book littered with success stories from all the people this work has helped along the way. And maybe I don't even need to try to build my life around it. Maybe events like today will happen more frequently and my desire to follow through on this work will manifest whether I try to make it happen or not. What I'm discovering is that the power of understanding your emotions and how to leverage them properly can create powerful shifts in both your physical and emotional world. Just by understanding where you're coming from and how you want to feel, you can navigate even the trickiest of situations. Just like a GPS can take you anywhere you want to go just by knowing where you are and where you want to be. In this video, I'll try to dive deeper into this subject and hopefully discover some new insights along the way. So tune in if you're ready to explore those lower emotions in a new light and reclaim power you might have otherwise discarded. All right. So I think now I'm going to just talk about this concept of the power that we have the power that the lower vibrations offer us that we don't often enact. So I've been thinking about this lately about like, how can someone thrive in fear? How can you, for every physical environment there is that we know of, there is some being or creature or animal that has found a way to adapt and thrive in that environment. And so if we as humans have an emotional environment and all the different emotions that we're capable of experiencing, then perhaps there is a adapted version of us that can thrive in each of those environments. And I'm saying this not as a, I'm not trying to like say like, all right, we should learn to thrive in negative emotions rather than learn to be in a more positive place. But that there can be, it's like you can be, imagine if you had, let's say, like a some kind of a route, like a delivery route, and you delivered to all these different places. Now, you could still live wherever you wanted to live, spend your free time wherever you wanted to spend your free time. But as you're going about these, all these different aspects of the city, you could, you know, you could be friendly with every person you encounter. So, you know, and people in all different neighborhoods, you could have a different rapport with different people. And to me, I see that as a tremendous plus. Like, why not, instead of feeling distant and as if people that maybe are different than you or maybe don't see things the way you see things offer you no value, you could find a way to connect with them and essentially thrive in your little interaction with them. And that ability to, I guess, make the most out of your environment then can allow you to, I don't want to say, like, so to bring it back to an emotional level, I don't know if you can get to a place where you maybe enjoy fear, but I think maybe you can, because people go to horror movies for the entertainment value. So there's obviously some value there. And could you enjoy being a victim? I'm certain you could. I'm certain there are some people who, you know, they might even have a fantasy of being a victim in some way. And so if joy and love can be threads that connect through all the lower emotions, even though they're present in different ways, then maybe we're just misunderstanding some of these lower emotions. Maybe all fear is a distortion of love. It's not the absence of it, but a version of it that is so wildly different from what we've come to know as love that we behave completely different to it. But if you can learn how to, like, unentangle the distortion that fear causes, then you can essentially see clearly. You can see a clear picture even though fear is present. It reminds me of this this news story I saw once where this guy put a picture of him, but he had like a swirl on his face that was like done by Photoshop. And so the police just took that picture, used the same software to unswirl his face, and then boom, crystal clear. You could see the guy's face and easily identify him, and that's how he got caught. And that is sort of like that ability to unswirl the scrambled picture that fear may cause us to see things. Because fear can make fear can make the unknown terrifying. Fear can make somebody just like tapping on your shoulder, it could cause you to jump. And so like all these super distorted things, which you know, may or may not be, sometimes fear is 100% appropriate, and fear can make you run from the thing that's trying to kill you, and your desire to live will cause you to have a fear reaction. Because if you were like seriously depressed or wanted to die, and you were around something trying to kill you, you'd be like, go ahead, do it, you know. and that is the, So if you have a fear reaction to something, then that means that you have a desire that is essentially, it's essentially different than what your fear is predicting. Your fear is predicting your life might end. Your desire is for your life to continue. And so if we can understand fear as a distorted predictor, then we can learn to work with it better. We could learn to unscramble it even while we're amidst the fear, and understand that some things may appear dangerous but actually pose no threat to us. And then we can be around that thing that we once feared and have a different response to it. And so it's kind of weird when you're working in the realm of emotions, because when you have a once you stop feeling fear, then aren't you no longer in fear? Didn't you essentially just transcend, you essentially just go to a different neighborhood? And sure, that's accurate, but maybe the thing about emotions is they're not concrete. They are shiftable. So you could have a relationship based on fear with something and shift that relationship, and how you see that thing and how you respond to that thing and how you behave towards it will completely shift as well. And so to bring that back into victimhood, if you are feeling like a victim to something, a victim to circumstance, a victim to someone else's actions, a victim to maybe your own inability to follow through on something that's really important to you, then there is too a gift in that. There is something about understanding. So here's what happens when you acknowledge that you're feeling like a victim. You understand that you don't have the power. And so you stop expecting yourself to shift the situation as if you do have the power. Somebody, pulls a gun on you, they have the gun, you don't. You don't expect yourself to shoot them in the head or to like tell them off, or you expect yourself to just calm the hell down and for most people, maybe, or maybe that's just how I do it. Be like, all right, this person has a gun, it's pointed at my head. Maybe it'd be best if we de-escalate the situation. And so oftentimes what applying power does is it escalates the situation. And so to de-escalate the situation, you kind of have to it's almost like a disarming thing. You can't come in, you come in guns blazing at someone with the guns, you're probably gonna get shot. But if you come in a disarming way, which first involves disarming yourself. So when you're acting as a victim, you are essentially acknowledging that you do not pose a threat to that other person. You are disarmed, you're the victim, they're the perpetrator or whatever you want to call it, and so they have the power in that dynamic. And in so doing that, if you honor how you feel in that, and instead of trying to overpower them when they have the power, you disarm yourself and disarm them, then you can create a situation where you're shifting it not through brute force, not through how do I put it? Not you're shifting it indirectly. Instead of being the obvious, turning the situation on its head, taking the gun away from someone, you instead just look for a way to neutralize the situation, and essentially try to. And this is something we talked about. If you saw the videos on non-complimentary behavior, somebody puts a gun to your head, and you respond back in a hostile way, that's probably not going to end too well for you. But if somebody puts a gun to your head and you respond back in a loving way, well, there's really no protocol for how that might unfold. You're probably not going to, you're probably not going to do anything to incite getting shot by beaming love, and you may just transcend the situation by opening things up to a new light, so to speak. By opening your introduction of love sort of throws off the ecosystem of your typical gun to a head situation. And in so doing can open up possibilities that before might have been unfathomable. So the power of being a victim is so let's get back to this dynamic of disarming yourself. If you acknowledge yourself as a victim, you stop expecting yourself to change the situation the way you want it. It essentially creates a space for you to make peace with the temporary dynamic the way it is, because you are acknowledging that you do not currently feel like you have the power to shift it. And to some people that may be a turnoff to say that someone doesn't have the power to shift their situation. But there are times when we don't. There are times when somebody, maybe the strongest person in the world, is completely exhausted and can't lift something, even though they're incredibly strong. And there are times when, even though we're incredibly powerful as individuals, we cannot shift something, even though we have that power, because whatever gives us that power is sapped or tapped or just unavailable to us. And when we can acknowledge that, then we can know to act appropriately. It'd be like if you were a lawman or something, or somebody in the Wild West, and you came like rolling into the saloon and you were just like shooting your mouth off, and then you go to reach for your gun and you realize there's nothing in your holster. It would be smart to know ahead of time that there's nothing in your holster. And that's kind of what the energy of being a victim is. It says that your normal source of power is not available right now, so improvise. And once you acknowledge that, you stop trying to, like, there's no reason to expect yourself to do something that's not within your power. And in fact, your expectation is to do something that is, that harmonizes with the current situation. Like, so you're a victim, there's a gun to your head, just chill out and, you know, cooperate. And that sounds sometimes, that sounds a little disempowering to just say cooperate with somebody else's will. And that doesn't mean that you have to do something that you really, you know, there are certain lines that maybe you would want to resist, and that's certainly appropriate. If it feels appropriate to say no to something, even though there's a gun to your head, and say no to it. And if it feels appropriate to take some other action, take some other action. But the point is that by acknowledging how you feel, you then have essentially, it's like you're giving you're giving accurate coordinates to the GPS. Because if the GPS thinks you're still at home and you're all the way at work, and then it, you know, and you plug in where you want to go, you're going to get wildly different directions. And it's the same sort of thing emotionally. If you aren't aware of where you are emotionally and you try to do something that's going to cause you to, you try to do something that's going to help you step more into your power, or help you control the situation, or help you create the outcome you want, but you don't know where you are emotionally, you might have some trouble with that, because your actions will not, it's like different sets of actions work when you're in a different emotional place. And when you can learn what actions are effective given how you're feeling, then you can successfully navigate different terrain. So if we bring the city analogy, if you have a city with all, like, you know, different terrain and different ecosystems, and then there are appropriate ways to travel or appropriate things to do. So it's like you might drive on a pavement, or even drive on grass, or even drive through snow or through a frozen area. But you probably wouldn't want to drive through something incredibly muddy, or maybe something incredibly sandy, or a body of water. And so you are aware of what different modes of transportation, you're aware of what things work relative to that particular circumstance or that particular environment, and then you can easily act appropriately. In our physical world, it's so obvious when something fails. But in your emotional world, it's not always so obvious, because A, we're not always paying attention, and B, sometimes we think that something else caused the failure, and it wasn't that we were simply using an action that we weren't emotionally equipped to find success with in that moment. And so that's the real, I think, the power of the this emotional work that I am wanting to dive deeper into, and wanting to make it my life's work, and wanting to write books about it, and wanting to do coaching about it, and teach classes about it, and just connect with others who have an interest in finding smoother interaction or smoother being able to shift more easily, working more in harmony with how they feel, and thus getting radically easier and more significant results. And so where I'm going with this is essentially wanting to understand emotions so deeply that when I feel fear, I feel the gift of fear, and I have access to, because in a place of fear, you have access to tools that you don't have to when you're in a place of love. It's like there's nothing really to overcome when you're in a place of love. There's more of like, or a place of appreciation. When you're just appreciating something, you're just appreciating something. There's no drive to change it. But when you're afraid of something, then there is a drive to change something. There is a drive to get moving. Fear can really light a fire under your ass. And that fire is a source of power. And there's a, and there's no reason that we should have to give up that fire in order to, it's like life is better when you also have that fire. There's a reason that fire exists, and it's not just because it can burn you. It's, you know, it's because there's so many uses for it. You know, you cook your food, it keeps you warm, burning up in the sky right now. If it's daylight out and shining down upon you and creating so much life. And that power source is not something that we need to deny ourselves, especially when I think we're reaching a stage as a society and as a human race where like so much of our power is going to be outsourced with automation and with technology and with all the things that are now going to be capable of being done for us, then there's going to be a desire for us to do more with us now that we'll have less of our focus being on what we actually do with ourselves in terms of like, you know, what would you do to pay the bills or what you do to do the work? The more that gets automated, then the more time we'll have to just be and get back to being human beings instead of human doings. And so I'm really looking forward to where this work is going to take us. All right, everyone. So I hope you enjoyed this talk on the power of being a victim and everything that was sort of intertwined with it. And yeah, so if you have any feedback, any thoughts of your own, would love to dialogue more with you on it. Or if you're interested in, if you've seen some videos of me doing the emotional work with the emotional scale, which I could probably pull up really quick. Let's see here. Yeah, all right. That is a slide here. Here we go. Yeah, so the emotional scale here. And again, that's not the topic. So yeah. If you have interest in doing some of this work, I would love to potentially do some live shows where I'm helping walk somebody else through this. And it doesn't necessarily have to, you don't have to be on video if you don't want to be, if you just want to have, you know, a fake name and you want to talk over the phone while we go live. I think that it could be beneficial for a lot of reasons. One, because your personal desires will help drive us in a unique direction that I wouldn't go if I was just doing the process on my own. And then two, that other people are able to then benefit from the unique place that you steer it, all the insights that come up, all the unique aspects of your personal desire. So yeah, if you are indeed, if you're interested in if you've seen some of the videos that I've done on this and you have something that you don't feel good about, that you want to feel better about, I'm looking forward to playing with this process more and creating a format that helps benefit more people. All right, everyone. Have a good one.